thank you saying that.
Oh, yeah.
Years, you need to, I'll make it as long as someone says, I guess normally I don't need anybody's permission, but I was going to make a quick glass cover, route out so that they have volume control and like three or four, that's all they need, and make it. And then no one can get in, pass the mess, and
just turn it on, turn it up and down, that's it.
Yep.
Good morning.
You're not on.
Try it again, Corey. You're not on.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to see you all. I know some people are going to be coming in here in a few minutes, but we'll we want to welcome you. If it is your first time with us, we're glad that you're here. We have our connection cards in the back of the chair, and we'd love for you to fill those out and take them to our guest, our connection table out here, and our welcome desk. We have a gift for you we'd like to share with you. We are glad that you're here this morning, and hope this morning you can really connect with God. We do have a few announcements we want to make. And one is that this past Thursday we had a fundraiser. The United Methodist Women held a fundraiser for the Uganda mission trip, where we're taking dentists and hygienists over there to do, not only to do cleaning in different dental clinics, but we're also doing some training of some of the nurses that are there in hygiene work. And what I found out on Thursday evening was that there are no hygienist clinics there. There are no hygienist education, right? There's a school for hygiene. So we are training some of the first hygienists in Uganda. And so the nurses that are there, this is the first time they're getting trained. They're going to be equipped for that. And so we're starting something brand new there in Uganda. So our church is a part of something that could, just have some serious wings and go across that country. The dentist, what I was told there, the dentist will do different dental things, pulling teeth, doing some surgeries like that, but they don't do cleaning. And so we're introducing that, which will go a long way in that. But we're able to raise $2,020 that night to go towards this trip and to recover some great things. And so if you're still interested in participating in, and we can use your prayers and you can use your money and your support, but we'll tell you some more about that as we go along. The other announcement we have is that the dancers that we have are, Hillary is the leader of our dance team, and they're looking for some people. So if you're interested in that, just send an email to the church, call in Tony, speak to Hillary. I don't think her number and info is in the bulletin, so we want to let you know about that. The last thing is that Tuesday night at 6:30, we're having a meeting and talking about the upcoming general conference of the United Methodist Church that's in February. It's a special called conference on human sexuality and inclusion. We're voting on how we're going to move forward with ordination and same-sex marriages, and understanding the full scope of what that looks like, which way the church is going, understanding all the different things that are involved with the LGBTQ plus community. And so there's a vote coming in at the end of February. We're just going to explain the different implications of that, what that looks like, and what that means. And as best we know, just to sort of share hopes, concerns, whatever it might be. And we're not there to solve problems, but we're there to know what to pray for exactly, and where you can find out more information. But if you want to come Tuesday night, we'll be sharing some of that Tuesday night at 6:30. With that is all the announcements I have at this time. There's some other things in the bulletin we want to share with you, but we'd love to invite you to stand with me as we pray. And what we do here, we extend our hands in an act of reception that we might receive the presence of Christ that's already here. So let me guide you through prayer. Holy Spirit. Fill us with your presence. Fill us with your love. Give us the courage to follow you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So what we'd like you to do now is to take some time to greet your neighbor, share your name, ask people how they're doing, move across the aisle to somebody you haven't seen in a while or haven't met yet. Make sure you do that. Take time to be friendly. Thank you.
in many directions. This day, in this place, let service to God be your choice. Blessed be the God of creation who has called us here.
Feels like surrendered in my strength. Lost without hope, no place to begin. Thank you.
salvation that you've offered us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please have a seat. We are in the middle of our stewardship campaign, if you will. It's not one of my favorite words, but it's a word. And the campaign part, stewardship, I love. It's the idea that God has given us and blessed us with so much, and then what do we do with that? How do we take care of the resources we've been given? And Terry Jackson is the chair of our finance committee, and he's going to come up and share a few words. And so I just invite you to come on up here, Terry.
I was in the military, they said, keep it short, keep it simple, whatever. This is a day the Lord has made, rejoice and be glad. And I want to share just a couple of statistics here with you that are amazing to me. These were just published. And this is accounted to Area Vibes, that's an online source for Riverview, Florida, stating that Riverview, Florida now has a population of 90,000 people. It's the 400th largest city in the United States. The population density is 1,832 per square mile, which is 524%. Don't be too dazzled by these, but they are remarkable. 524% higher than the Florida average, and 1,922% higher than the national average. Figure that, in Riverview, Florida. That's fantastic. Median age is 34, approximately 17% lower than Florida average of 42. And in Riverview, 57% of the population over 15 years of age are married. 76% speak English, 18% speak Spanish. 39% of Riverview residents are born in Florida, 43% are born out of state. 6 were born outside the United States, and 12 were foreign born. Now, out here on Big Bend Road, there are 30,000 cars a day passing by this building. And this remarkable, beautiful 10-acre campus here. And we've got to promulgate, proclaim the word of Christ in grocery lines, in the barbershop, in wherever you meet your fellow human beings to proclaim the word of God and to say, hey, come join us. We have a fine place here, and we can make this into an electric, dynamic organization, which it is, and it's growing. We need to have it burgeoning. We need to have these walls bursting down. We need to expand. And frankly, we have a grand expansion plan that's available architecturally to us for the future. And we need to make that happen. Those figures there, in terms of the 30,000, that's verified by the Department of Transportation and by the Tampa Bay Times, who published this about 2 weeks ago. Most immediate need for staffing is for worship coordinator, choir director, or worship coordinator / choir director, however, and our dear pastor, whom we love, can't operate all by himself here. I refer to the first service calling him a one-armed paper hanger, but he can't do it all himself. We need people. We need a youth pastor, and it comes with reinforcing and enhancing our church's outreach and attraction to the community that surrounds us. Programs. We have a plethora. That's a $5 way of saying we got a bunch. And it's a backpack ministry, youth ministry, children's ministry, women's ministry, mothers of preschoolers, that's the famous MOPS program, M-O-P-S program, missions, the United Methodist Church district obligation. Now that's the big guy. The district obligation amounts to tens of thousands of dollars that we are promised to a mandatory giving to the district each year. Small groups ministry, Stephen ministry, family promise, community outreach, and should I go on? And there's more, but I won't go on. Now we're progressing into our season for stewardship. And The Lord God Almighty asks us to give the first fruits of our labor to Him and to support Him. My wife and I do tithe. We tithe by the old 10% rule. And we're retired and we're on fixed income, but we do tithe. The point is that you give something of your time, your talents, and of your wealth back to the church. It's essential. It's a scriptural component of our lives if we're to believe and follow Christ. There's a nationally syndicated financial consultant. His name is Dave Ramsey. Dave Ramsey was approached by a church who owed $100,000. And Dave Ramsey says, well, folks, here's what you do. And they were advised by Dave. He says, you very simply give above your normal giving $83.33 a month for each member for 1 year. And bada bing, here's $100,000. The math works. It really does. So we took this down to extrapolate that and found out that if we had 300 people, that brings that amount to a little over $22 per month, or less than the cost of a cup of Starbucks coffee. And I actually had a cup to show, but I forgot it.
Not the milkshake version of the Starbucks.
But the point is, for 92 and a half cents per day, with no other giving other than what you have given already or are giving already, if you increased your amount by 92 and a half cents per day, you could propel another $100,000 into our budget in a year. If 300 people gave, the math works. And that's pretty amazing. But God bless you. Thank you for your attention. And let's make this a very successful campaign this year for stewardship. God bless. Thanks.
So I was even saying less than the milkshake Starbucks. You know, the $6 cup, whatever, you know, 97 cents a day?
92 and a half cents.
Yeah,
essentially less than this.
Yeah, which is a basic cup of coffee is $2.37 at Starbucks, I think. Not that I know that. We're going to talk more about that card that you have later in the service. But let us, this time, we're going to call our worship support team to come forward as we begin praying about how we're living out our mission here in the community, how we come along together and go, how do we best use our resources, our 10 acres here, to bring light into this community. And so each week we ask God to share with us how we can become the people He's called to be. Who is He calling us to be? Where is He calling us to go? What is He calling us to give? And when we answer that, we live that out, we begin to see amazing changes happen in our lives and in the lives of those around us. So let's pray and offer ourselves up to God. Lord, we thank You so much for who You are and that You've called us to live in Your mission and life and love. We pray that You would use these gifts in our lives for Your glory and Your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, you are such a good God, and we want to come and praise your name this morning, lift up our lives to you, and that we can trust in you, that you're perfection, and you are good, and that you are a God of generosity and life and hope. And so we want to rest in that this morning. We come with all the weariness of the week and to place it before your feet to discover you fresh and new in our life. We know that we've fallen short and we have not been all you've called us to be. And so we seek, and through this worship time, your forgiveness, knowing that you freely give it to us. We don't want to take that for granted, but we know in asking, we remember that you are good and you do love us. So let us live out of that love. Give us the courage to do that. We bring up to you the people of our this world that are in turmoil and hurt and pain, and those who have been suffering, whether it's from weather and war and poverty. God, we lift them, all of us, up to you. And we pray that as we lift them up, as we see the needs and the hurts, that you would stir something in us and show us how we can be part of the answered prayer. We lift up those in our community, those who are in our own church who are suffering and struggling, who are sick in the hospital, and who are wondering what to do next in their life. We lift them up to you, that you would bring a healing touch there as well. That we can be the body, your body here, your hands and your feet to one another, so we can be strong to be in this world together. So as we do this, we now come to you and seek your face, to listen for your voice. We just want to still our souls, our minds, and so we can hear you and breathe in your breath. Take time now to say thank you. Thank you that you hear our prayers, and we pray now as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, spirituality has become a very abstract topic in our world. We talk about it, but it's sort of, it's either out there or so deeply personal that we just say, I'm spiritual. As a matter of fact, there's this phrase that you've all said. I've said it before. I've heard it said. I'm spiritual. I'm not religious. No, I'm not a religious person, but I'm a spiritual person. And I think some of that has been out of response to when churches seem to get very dogmatic and very judgmental of keeping people at a distance, going, if you're not like us, you can't become like us. And so we want to separate ourselves from the idea of religion and the idea of dogma. And so we moved into this place of spirituality. But I think we've gone so far to the other side is that we've become so spiritual we've forgotten the practical aspect of being of being creatures that are physical and understanding how does spirituality affect us? How does it, how do we live out of it? Spiritual, not religious language, it enables us to have theoretical ideas of beliefs without actual practical implications. And this is why it's always kind of laugh when people want to be Facebook friends with me. I'm like, you know, your pastor's going to see everything that you have. And I do. And I go, well, that's not what we talked about on Sunday. And this is why I don't post a lot of stuff on myself. But the idea is, well, how do we tend to go, we're spiritual, but what is the practical implications of what does that look like in the rest of my week? How does it affect? So when we say we're spiritual, not religious, I think what it's given us permission to do is it's kept us, we don't have to monitor our faith. We don't have to monitor how we talk about our enemies. We don't have to monitor how we spend our time or how we treat others or how we spend our money. When we say we're spiritual, not religious, we can go, it's just something I feel. And the problem with feelings is that they are so, there are so many things that can affect your feelings. I know that there's so many of us that if there's been at one point you've either been mad or you've been crying about something, if somebody came up and asked you, what are you mad or crying about, you would go, I don't know. Anybody ever had that? Has anybody ever woken up mad at somebody? Let's just go there first. Has anybody ever discovered that the reason they were mad at that person wasn't because of anything that person did, but because of a dream you had? See, it's weird. You're like, I've got this thing, and then you find out, oh, wait, this didn't even really, really happen. And so feelings they're not always the best judge of what to do. And so we've got to find this place of how do we live out our faith, and how do we make it practical? There's Amy Carmichael is a well-known evangelist and minister, and she said, you can give without loving. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. That's pretty powerful. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. And we're called to be a people of, you know it? Of love. We're called to be a people of hope, and we're called to a practical faith. And part of that is giving. And how we live that out. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. A few years ago, we talked about this verse from 1 Peter 3. Anyone know? I've been really impressed. Someone said, well, let me tell you. It says this, so you'll remember it. But in your hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. You hear that again. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. He goes on to say, this is how you do that. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. But the important thing there is looking at always being ready to answer when asked about the hope that you have in Christ. And so this is a great idea. It's a great way to evangelize. People go, oh, let me tell you about that hope and that you have. And so be prepared to give answer to that. The problem is Michael Frost, or a theologian, says, is that no one's asking, are they? And they're not asking because they don't want to hear about religion or faith. They're asking because they don't recognize the difference between them and us. They don't see a difference in how we live. They don't see extra generosity. That's why we talk about bells every week. Bells is that idea, because if I believe that if we go out and you bless three people a week, one of them not in your faith community, if you do something kind and you start living that way, and you eat and take time to hear people's stories and share your story, and you're spending time in prayer, listening to Jesus, you're spending time learning Jesus, reading scripture, and you remember that you're a sick person, remember your vocation to be a bridge to God, reflection of who God is. If we're doing those things, people will eventually start going, why are you so different? What's different about you? But we don't always do that because we're spiritual and not religious. We never find the practicality of that. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. I heard this interesting, we're reading the books, hearing this stat about you probably saw it too, and I'll remind you of it. I'm gonna try to do this without. These are part of my food prepping that I've been trying to do. Not as Mary asked me, he says, are those empty Chinese takeout boxes that you're eating? That would have been last year. So if you imagine this is the population of the world. The United States, if each one of these little boxes here represent all the billions of people in this world, you take the United States population, we represent 5% of that population. This is us. This is our percentage right here. 5% of the population and is right there. And so this is the rest of the world. 5% of the population. And then if we, if you turn this into all the natural resources of the world, the people that all of the world's population consume, we consume 25%. Our 5% of the population consumes 25% of the world's natural resources. Just let that sink in for a minute. Now, let's move this back to the population of the world. There's our 5% over there. The amount of waste that we produce. Does anyone remember the number? 40% of the waste produced in the world is produced by 5% of the population, which is us. We produce, the United States produces, the 5% of the world's population, 40% of the world's waste and garbage. What that tells me is, this isn't about shaming, but it's about opportunity of how we live our life. What this tells me is that we can afford to be generous. We can live our life better. It creates, generosity creates space and life for the world. It changes the world's dynamics when we are generous in how we live. 1 Timothy 6:17 says this: as for those who in the present age are rich, and if you take the, if we're 5% of the population and we consume 40% of the world's resources, and we, or no, I'm sorry, 25, how would they relate that? If we consume 25% of the world's resources and produce 40% of the garbage, then we can put ourselves in the rich category compared to the rest of the world. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous, ready to share, thus storing up for themselves a treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of a life that really is life. And we're called to invest ourselves in the things that are eternal. I talked about last week, if you take a post-it note home, go home and put it on everything that's eternal, everything that, you know, is lasting. There's only a few things that it's going to go on. God created us with this willingness to give, this desire to give. We have that in us that we want to give. We want to share our resources. And we're created that way, to give to God, to give to others. And this design is part of our makeup. And we actually have a need to be generous. There is a tug in us to be generous. Yet there are two voices in our heads. And some people have more voices than others. But there are two main voices that we have working in our heads, and that work against this idea of us giving. And those two voices, the first voice is the voice of fear. It's the voice of fear. It's a misplaced idea about the true source of our security. What we do is we say our security is in the stuff that we have. It's in the resources that we have. And the true source of our security is in God, of trusting God's economics and not the world's economics. The world's economics are that of scarcity. It says there's not enough. And God has an economy that is very different. It's an economy of abundance. See, the other voice is that of self-gratification. And our culture tells us that our lives consist in the abundance of our possessions and pleasurable experiences. So we find ourselves thinking, if I give, then there won't be enough for me to enjoy life. And that's why this speaks volumes to me. If we can take 5%, because we're so often comparing ourselves to our neighbor But it's not a fair comparison because they're also in the 5% of the world that has resources to spare. We're comparing ourselves, why not to the rest of the billions of people in the universe and see what they have? And if they're able to find happy and satisfaction in a place where there's nothing, then maybe we need to rethink our priorities and what it is that brings us life and hope. That there is enough, there is plenty. There is plenty. How do I defeat those voices? How do I get rid of those voices that say there's not enough? You need to store up. How do I remove those? Well, the simple answer is this. It's practice. We have to practice doing, we have to do practical things that we do. There's a game on today. The Super Bowl, and the Patriots are playing the Rams. I don't wait till the end. I don't like the Patriots. The end. No. But here's the thing. The Patriots, there's a couple reasons I don't like them. One is because they win. And it's purely, it's amazing. It's gone past where I just don't like them to going, this is amazing. Tom Brady sold his soul, apparently. But the thing that drives me crazy about the Patriots is that I like to compare them to the sandwich that my daughter orders from Subway. It's white bread, it is turkey, and it is American cheese. That's it. It's the most plain, dry sandwich you have. This is, to me, the Patriots. It's plain, and if I'll give you proof from Belichick's mouth. 2 years ago, he was at one of their, I think it was last year's Super Bowl. It doesn't matter. One of the Super Bowls that they've been in for the eternity. They were at, and he's doing one of these rallies in Boston and getting everyone to rally. And he's bragging. He says, our team, they show up to practice every day. And they're, the Patriots' motto is do your job, by the way. I don't know if you know this. It's do your job, which is not a bad motto, but it's really dry. And there's nothing flashy about it. Do your job. The other thing is, he says, they showed up to work every day. We didn't have any days off. And so he tried to chant, get them to do a chant with him. You know what the chant was? No days off. Isn't that a pep rally? They weren't even shouting it back to him, but Belichick, he just kept going, no days off. Here's the thing, as dry and boring as that is, they win Super Bowl. Why? Because they practice, they show up, they do their job. I hate them. They practice. You have to practice. And the more you practice, the better you get. It's the same thing. I was listening to an interview, and Kenny G was on it, who, by the way, is really surprisingly funny. And he was there, it's like, are you worse? Do you find that as you've gotten older that you're not? And he says, with musical instruments, if you keep practicing every day like I do, you get better. I'm better than I used to be. We practice it. As we practice generosity, we move past those voices of fear. We move past those voices of doubt, and we get into this place where our heart grows. It's like the Grinch. Our heart grows three sizes. It enriches us. Generosity breeds generosity. It's a fruit of spiritual growth. And as Jesus Christ moves in us, he's prompting us to move in these different places. And as we've responded, you have a choice. You can either practice and respond to the movement of the Holy Spirit in you, or you don't. And the more you respond to it, the more that grows, the more you reject it, the more that withers away. Are we moving into it? Are we living into this life? I saw this, it was an advertisement, I fixed it. This picture up here, I think it's still in there. And this made me laugh a little bit and sad. It has Jesus with the disciples at desk. This is picturing the disciples wearing their Sunday best, taking notes on filling the blank handouts, and then parting ways for lunch seems strange. Because that's not how they did it. They went out and they started practicing immediately. Jesus said, go out and do it. He didn't even always give them instructions. He said, just go try it. Come back when you make all your mistakes and we'll go from there. And it's that back and forth. Are we living? Are we stopping here at our desks? Are we going out and living it and putting it into practice? Generosity breeds generosity. And we're called to be a generous church. We're called to be generous with who we are and how we do that. And to be the church we're called to be, it requires us being generous. So the biblical reasons in there, and we've shared some of them, but in Acts it says it's more blessed to give than to receive. To those who want to, Jesus said, to those who want to save their life will lose it. To those who lose their life for my sake will find it. And Psalm says the earth is the Lord's and all that is in it. And so we remember, we just put our focus back on who is our foundation in our life. The early days in the Old Testament, they talked about the tithe. Abraham was the first one to do this, the tithe with 10% of their crops and their crops and their flocks, and they would bring those to God, and Abraham was the first to do that. That 10%, which is where we get the idea. And the Christian, the Christians who live, we live under a new covenant. We're not bound by the law of Moses, but we look to it as a guide. And so, yet most Christians agree that the tithe is a good guideline for our lives and one that's pleasing to God. And it, I know it can be a struggle at times. I've struggled with this in my life, and when I finally get into that place where, like, you know, God, this is what I want to give, and be able to give beyond that. I don't like talking about what I give, so I'm just saying that I do it, and to say that I believe in it, and you find that it becomes easier to do it the more you do it, and to say this is a good thing to give. Give back to the community, give back to the church, and do that, and to give the church and an extra to other places. We do that. But I also understand that it can be a hardship for some people, depending on where you are. What God wants to do is help you get healthy. And so where is he calling you at this moment? Some people, you may have given zero. And God's saying, okay, this year, let's try 1%. Let's move you and get you into health. And maybe you've been given 5, and you want to give 6. And wherever it is, what is God calling you to do that? God understands where you are and will help you make the adjustments necessary to become more generous. But we have to be open to his movement in our life. Tithing's a floor. It's not a ceiling. God calls us to grow beyond the tithe. We should strive to set aside an additional percentage of our income for offerings or other things important to us, missions, projects, schools, church buildings. How can we be generous in our life? What it means to God, it's not that God's going up there, you know what, I need to do Alexis. It's not that he needs your money for that, but he rejoices in how we become generous with each other and how we respond to that. And when we do that, when we're generous to God and our families, our friends, our neighbors, and others, our hearts are filled with joy. We all know the joy. I'm sure every one of us has had one time when we've had money in our pockets and somebody needed it, and we're like, you know, I want to use this for a Coke or a sandwich. And go, this person really needs it. And we give them, it may not be the last dollar in our bank account, but it's the last one in our pocket. And go, you know, here, you take this. And the joy that comes from that. There's something about rediscovering our humanity and giving. Now, I also want to say this. Many Christians get it wrong. We think if I give money, then God will give back. I've heard that preached. I think the prosperity gospel is horrible. I will say that right out in front. The idea that if I give God, then God wants to get, you know, give me a Porsche. And the more I give, then I'm going to have a bigger house. It doesn't work like that. Jesus said, we die to ourselves. Jesus said, give away what we have. He said it's difficult for the rich. There's a lot of things in there that are like that. But he does say, trust and rework your life so we're dependent upon him. God is. In our life. That is the call. That is the movement. And so trust in him with that. Just because you give doesn't mean your life is going to be rosy. Trust in God and you will see amazing things happen in your life. We have commitment cards that we've passed out. This is not to fill out for today, but I want you to take those and pray about it. How is God moving you? Next week we're going to have a time when we bring those up and dedicate our tithes for the year to God and make our pledges. We use those pledges to make our budget and for the year. And so as soon as we have all those, we'll be able to set our budget. But I want you to take those and seriously think about how you can pray. Where is God leading you? I'm not here to strong arm you. I'm here to say this is how God teaches us and where he's showing us and leading us. And we can choose to be a part of that. This 10 acres of property that we have here. We can be a light in this community, but it takes our resources to go. Let's take some time to pray. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are here in this place, that you love us, and you guide us with your love. We want to know you better. We want to serve you better. And we just pray that you would guide us. Give us the courage to step out in faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus' life is essentially saying we're not just spiritual, we're physical. And the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. Give thanks to you, Father Almighty. He broke the bread. And he said, take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to you, Father Almighty. He gave it to his disciples and said, take, drink. This is the blood of my new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me. And so, Lord Jesus Christ, we ask that you would bless these gifts of bread and wine, that they might be for us your body and blood, that we might be reconciled to you and to one another, that we might live out your works, your mission here in this world. Guide us in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite the worship support team to come. As we prepare for this next season in our lives, let's begin with a prayer of confession. Would you pray with me? Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your law. Hear the good news. Jesus Christ died for you while we were yet sinners. This proves his love for us. I'd like you to repeat this to me and to one another. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Amen. I want to tell you a few things as the worship team prepares. And, we're going to invite you to come down. Just a moment, we come down the outer aisles, return to the inner aisles. We have stations in each corner. The one in the middle is gluten-free. The ushers will hand you a part of the bread, and you'll take that, and you'll take that bread, and you'll dip it to the cup, and then you can partake. And so if you get all of that wrong, go down the wrong aisle, bump into people, it's okay. Here's what's important. Everybody in here is invited to the table. Now, you don't have to be a member here or anywhere else. If you want Jesus Christ, we invite you to come and receive. So come as you are and receive with his grace. Thank you. God, we thank you for this holy mystery that you are present with us in all things, and we want to receive your grace this day. In Jesus' name, amen. So the reason we hate the Patriots is because they win. It's because they win. They win. And but here's the thing. I want Satan to hate us as much as many people don't like the Patriots. Because we win. In Jesus Christ, we win. We have freedom. We have hope. We have life. And that is the call that we have. And in that hope and life, we go out and we share. So remember your bells. Practice your faith. Go bless. Go eat. Go listen and learn. Remember your sin and share the love of Christ with everyone you meet. Enjoy your day. Find love. Share that love with everyone you meet. Amen.
Thanks, Jared.
Good to be here.